Hello, I'm Selmateacher7, also known as Mr. Barry by my students, and today is day number 21 for the A-plus curriculum course. Now, today we'll be talking about Freedompop, as well as a little bit into MagicJack, and what all that entails. We'll also be going into Chromebooks, as looking at the different screen sizes and a little bit different in the hardwares. And we'll be looking at changing our channels for the Chrome OS. Well, let's get started with the lesson. Day 21, troubleshooting, and we'll be talking about other topics. One is Freedompop. So let me go into Freedompop and tell you about that. Now, you can buy a Freedompop phone for around $40 at freedompop.com. And when you do, you get an account and you log into your Freedompop account. You do that using your email address and a password that you set up at the time. Now, what do you get at the Freedompop page? Well, when you log in, you're going to see your billing cycle, how many days you have left, your talk, your text, and how much data you have left. I'm using the free plan, which only gives me 1.5 gigs of free data a month, plus unlimited text and unlimited talking on that phone number for that Motorola E second generation phone. If I wanted to go into different plans, I click on account and plans, and then I can go up and I can upgrade. I can upgrade my plans to a premium. So I go, instead of getting 1.5 gigs free, I can go to 2 gigs free for only $20 more a month. Like I said, right now I'm getting it for free. I can look at the usage, devices, and other things here. I can go with billing. And here we see that you see current credit zero, and every month it's zero. So that's monthly charge, is nothing. At any time I could add or upgrade my services. So let's see here, let's look at some of the services. So I click on services. And if I want to get premium voice, that would be a higher quality voice. That's $3.99 a month. If I wanted to go over with a Wi-Fi hotspot, that's $3.99 a month. Basically, it'll turn your phone into a hotspot, and you can connect your Wi-Fi enabled devices like your laptops or your tablets to that Wi-Fi hotspot. And that's only $3.99. That's actually very, very good to have a hotspot around. And there's many other plans and services that you can upgrade to. Alright, so hopefully that has helped you in looking at Freedompop and what you get with it. Like I said, you'd go to some site like freedompop.com and buy the phone. And when you do, you activate your account using your email address. Now, if I want to find good deals from Freedompop, I can go to Sleek Deals. That's one place. And when I'm there, I just type in Freedompop, and I just did a search, and I found this Samsung Victory phone here for $30. And the sales go in and out. Let me take you to another one, Groupon.com. Once you're at Groupon.com, go into the search and type in Freedompop, and you'll find some deals there as well. I bought a few of these too. It says kids, but don't let it fool you. It's just comes with an app that you can uninstall, and it's a normal cell phone. There's nothing different between this Motorola E and any other Motorola E, just because it says the word kids on it. But that's a very good deal for that one there. And you have the, either get the white one which I bought, or you can go with the black version, any one that you want there. That'd be $40, and then again, you would sign up with your Freedompop, and you can go with the basic plan, which would be zero per month. So for $40, you can get out on board, get yourself a nice cell phone, and go on from there. And here's Freedompop phones, the Motorola E, two of those, I have those. You can also buy one of the these devices. This creates, this connects to 4G, and then you have a hotspot wherever you go. And when you get your device, it'll come in a box like this. One good thing that I did the other day was I downloaded an app from MagicJack, so I connected my MagicJack phone number with my Freedompop phone. So now when someone calls my MagicJack phone number, my telephones ring and I can talk to them on my cell phones. I can also make calls using the MagicJack number from my cell phones. Alrighty, let's go on to the next topic. Okay, I just want to give a quick overview of MagicJack. MagicJack, you'd find that at magicjack.com. And what is it? Well, it allows you to go in and use your internet as your phone line. And so you don't have to pay so much money. It could be $20 a year. So instead of $20 a month or something, it's much cheaper. And you get this device. And what this does is it receives the internet from your router or from your modem device, and then on the other side, guess what you connect to it? You connect your landline phone to it. And your phone, when you pick it up, it has a dial tone. And then you can call just like you did before, but you're using the internet. So it's called voice over internet protocol. And they have different sales going on. Groupon does have the same device for $20 if you're interested in actually buying one of those. You do get a phone number with it, or you can bring over your old phone number that you had in the past. Now, let's say that for some reason you don't like the quality that you're getting out of your MagicJack device. Well, just download the free app to your Android or your Apple phone, and guess what? As soon as you log into your MagicJack account, it knows your phone number. And whenever someone calls that phone number, your cell phones will ring as well, so that you can receive and call using your MagicJack's phone number using any cell phone. Guess what? The clarity is much superior than what it is with this device when you do this. So I would recommend anyone who has MagicJack to add it to their cell phone as that free app that you get from MagicJack. You can also get it from the Play Store on your Android device. Once you add the app to your smartphone, you log in, you'll say, oh, this is your assigned phone number from that device, and you can call from it, receive call from it, and have a lot of fun, because guess what? It's a much clearer call afterwards. Okay, let's go on now. All right. Our next topic is using multiple Google accounts on one PC. Let's go on to discovering how to put multiple Google accounts onto one Windows computer. Setting up multiple Google accounts onto one computer, you do need to have the other person's Gmail username and password or their credentials before doing this. And I'm going to talk about the scenario of why this would happen. Many times a family may have only one or two computers at home but have many people using those same computers. When one person logs into their Google account, another person needs to log out. After some time, the browser settings may have some of the first person's elements mixed in with the second person's elements. This can be very confusing to everyone. To fix this, we need to have multiple Google accounts on one computer. So here's an example. Here's my Google account with all my tabs, and I'm logged in as teacher here. And then I have another account over here. So this is another person, another account. And if I go in and I check mail comes up over here for that account. And if I go in here, so I have two totally different Google email accounts. This one is for one account over here on this side, and over on the left hand side is mine. Now there's no limit on how many Google accounts you can be using on one Windows PC. As far as I can see, you can put as many as you need. So let's go step by step on how to add additional accounts to your Windows PC. First off, when you're in the one Google account, you want to make sure that you are logged in as you. You click on the three dots, go down to settings, and then again, you're going to be seeing your email account here, just to make sure that you are the one logged in. You will see the other people who are logged in or have accounts on this computer as well. To add the next person, you have click on add person, and then you type in the person's name. So we'll type in that person's name, and then you choose an avatar, or you can just simply choose their icon, and that will be their picture that they use for their Google account. Click on add, and here we are. We're now in Ted's account. It's that easy. Now what Ted will have to do is he'll need to log into his account, and he does that very easily by clicking on Gmail and then click on sign in, and then this is where Ted would sign into his account and then click on next and then key in his password. Now let's say Ted doesn't have a Google account yet. He can create one at this time by simply clicking on create account right here at the bottom of the page. I might add at this time, if you wanted to remove anyone, just simply go on to their name in the settings tab and then go across and click on delete. When you do that, that account will be deleted from the Windows machine. Okay, so let me review just what we've done here. We start with the first person, and hopefully that would be the only account that you have on the machine to start with. They will be the administrator that controls the other accounts. That means they can delete the other accounts off of that Windows machine. One, you'd open up Chrome and log into your main account. Two, you click on the three bars or the three dots to find your settings. From the menu that comes down, you click on settings here. Make sure that you are signed in. Now, if you're not signed in, it'll look just like this. It'll be pink, and it says account sign in, details are out of date, sign in again. So if you do see this, make sure that you click on sign in, and then you key in the your username and your password before adding anyone else. Going on, after signing in, scroll down to the heading called People, which would be basically on the first page. After finding People, click on Add Person. And when you do that, you'll come up to this window. And from this window, you would type in the person's name into the box and then click on the Add button there. After clicking on the Add button, a new Google Chrome window will open. If you're working within a Windows PC, right-click the new Google icon found on the taskbar that would be at the bottom of the screen and select Pin to Taskbar. This will cause the new Google account to remain visible on the taskbar for the person to use again, making it easy for them to find it. Alrighty, and I have a screenshot of me doing just that. So that would be the new account there. I right-clicked it, it came up to here, and I choose Pin this program to Taskbar. So it's going to stay there, making it very easy for the next person to find their account while they're using your Windows computer. Now, sign into the other person's account using the new Google Chrome window, and then their account picture will show up, as we see here. 12. You will now see two Google Chrome accounts on the taskbar, as seen here on the image. And that is all you have to do. There will now be icons with their Google profile picture right there on the taskbar, letting everyone know whose Google is whose. Alrighty, we're now going to go into Chromebooks as our next topic. A Chromebook is a laptop that runs the Chrome OS. This causes the laptop to run very fast and to be safe from viruses. Yes, it's true. Chromebooks do not get viruses, which is wonderful. Plus, they never slow down. I've been using Chromebooks for many years and they don't slow down. My Windows machines, on the other hand, they slow down. After a few years, I noticed, hey, they're booting up rather sluggishly. But a Chromebook is still instant on every time. There are many versions of Chromebooks from every major computer company. They differ in screen size, color, processor type, and internal storage size. Chromebooks with Intel CPUs and categorized based upon their screen size. Now, the reason why I went to the ones with the Intel CPUs is because they are the fastest ones on the lot. I've owned many Chromebooks and I've tested all of them, and it's safe to say that the ones with Intel processors are much faster than based on any other processor. Right, the first one that I'm going to look at is the Acer 11.6 inch. That's a very small screen Chromebook here with 2 gigs of RAM. You save 2 gigs of RAM, still they're instant on and they load Microsoft Word or your Google Docs and Google Sheets. They play movies, they do everything that you want to do, like Facebook and everything else, YouTube, and they do everything instantly as long as you have an internet connection. Now, let's say that you don't have an internet connection, these laptops still work offline. But there, of course, you're not going to be watching a YouTube movie, because YouTube requires the internet. But if you have a movie on a jump drive, guess what? You can use your Chromebook to even watch a movie offline. This one here is from Groupon, and I found it on sale for $129. So that's not too shabby of a price. The next one that we have here is the Asus 13.3 inch Chromebook. Again, everything else is the same from Groupon for $199. Then the 14 inch HP Pavilion Chromebook 14, that has a 14 inch screen. This one's running $199, around $200. And then I also found the Acer 15.6 inch Chromebook, and that one has the same specs there. Solid state drive, which is great. $129 from Groupon. Now, that one there will go on and off of sale. So sometimes you'll see it at the normal price of around $400 or so, and then it will go back on sale to $129. I recommend buying it when you see it at $129 or less. Okay, here's the size difference of two Acer Chromebooks. This one over here is the 11.6 inch. And this one is the 15.6, we just call it the 16 inch. And we measure it diagonally on these. And let's see what we can do here. You notice that they're using the same processor, they're using the same hardware specs inside, but the larger one just gives you more room to see exactly what you're doing. So everything works well there. Okay, so again, you can see the difference now between the Acer 15.6 inch. This is the one that's on sale at Groupon for $129, compared to the 11.6 inch Acer, which you can also find at Groupon for a similar price. Okay, carrying on, now that we know the difference in the screen sizes between the smallest and the largest, let's go on now to other manufacturers, such as this Dell Chromebook. A lot of people say they do like these Dell Chromebooks, but they're a little bit more expensive, around the $330 mark. We also have a Toshiba 13.3 inch. That one's also around the $330 mark. HP comes out with a nice Chromebook with a 14-inch screen, and that one's about $350. And then there's also an Acer 15.6 inch Chromebook that has the Core i3 processor, a little bit more RAM, and that one's at $450. Now, let's look at Chromebooks based on other types of CPUs. Now, again, I don't recommend going with these other types of CPUs, but just to let you know that they do exist on the market. The Hisense 11.6 inch Chromebook that has the ARM Cortex A17 quad core processor, which is something that you'd find in a tablet, and that one's around $159. Sometimes I see it at Walmart for a little less, but it's usually around $160 right now. There's also the Acer 13.3 inch Chromebook here with the NVIDIA Tegra K1 processor for around $160. And then there's also this HP Chromebook 14 that has the NVIDIA Tegra K1 quad core processor that's going for around $227. Again, I don't recommend going with a Chromebook with one of these processors. I would stick with a Intel processor. Our next topic here is Chromeboxes. A Chromebox is a desktop computer that runs the Chrome OS. Since a Chromebox replaces a user's older desktop computer, it allows the users to use larger monitors and their USB keyboards from their old machines. There are many versions of Chromeboxes from every major computer company. They tend to hold a very powerful computer and a very small form factor. They all have built-in Wi-Fi. Here's a small table showing some of the common Chromeboxes. So here we have the ASUS Chromebox. I bought about 10 of these so far. This seems to be what the one that many people go with, and that one goes for around $160. You might find it at Newegg. You can also find it at other places such as Best Buy and Groupon. There's also a Dell Chromebox for about $150. And then there's an HP Chromebox for around $180. Now, all these have the same specs, the same hardware specs. So they all run pretty much head to head to each other. They're all instant on, very fast, very capable desktop computers, and look at their form factor. Their size is less than 5 inches across. So this area right here is less than 5 inches wide, and they're only 1.5 or 1.6 inches high. See this one here? Just a little bit above, 1.5 inches high. So they're very, very small little boxes that should be able to fit on anyone's desktop. Or you can even hide them behind your monitor or your HDMI TV. Now let's say that you do buy a Chromebox. You of course need to use a monitor, and that would be preferably be a newer HDMI monitor. If you didn't have one, it's easy to buy the adapter to convert your style to an HDMI, because that's the type of cable that plugs into your Chromebox, as you see down here. So number two is your Chromebox, then you have your keyboard and a mouse. And on this one here, everything's wireless, because you can buy wireless versions of everything. All right, next on the list is the DEV channel on Chromebooks. What is the dev channel? You can test the latest features on the Chrome operating system by switching channels to a more experimental version. The dev channel is short for developer's channel and sports a myriad of new features and settings that most do not see until months or even years later. According to Google, the dev channel is for those who want to see the latest Chrome OS features. The dev channel gets updated once or twice weekly. While this build is tested, it might have minor bugs, as they want people to see what's new as soon as possible. Okay, now you'll need to be the Chromebook owner to switch channels, so you won't be able to do this on guest mode. And to see the channel that you're using, simply click on to the status area where your account picture appears. So you click up in the corner where your name appears or your picture, and then click on settings, and then go on about Chrome OS. An about window will open with your version and number and channel for the Chrome OS. Now, how to enable the dev channel? Yeah, let's switch channels. Number one, you'd sign into your Chromebook with the owner's account. Two, click the status area where your account picture appears. Number three, you go to settings and then click on about Chrome OS. Now from there you should see something with more info. Number four, click on the change channel button. Number five, pick a channel from the box that appears. Restart it, and guess what? You are done. One feature that I like in Chrome is the tab mute. Let's learn how to enable or find Chrome's tab mute feature. Last year, Google Chrome introduced an easier way to find out which open tabs are playing sound, a feature that makes unexpected blasts from autoplay elements hidden on a web page far easier to deal with. Chrome's tab indicator can do more than simply show you which tab is now playing sound. Oh yes, this is a great feature to have. And it turns the nifty speaker icon into a clickable mute button. Aside from avoiding wear and tear on your keyboard's dedicated mute key, the feature works on a par tab basis, not a system-wide one. When a web page starts playing audio, be it inattentionally or otherwise, you can click the speaker icon to toggle the sound for that one tab off and click it again to toggle the sound back on. The flag also adds a command to the tab context menu for quick right click and shut up access. The tab muting feature in Chrome is enabled by default now. So here's how to test it. Open up a YouTube video or any other website that has sound and hit play. You should then see a speaker icon at the top. to silence that tab, click it, and it will mute that sound for you. And you can have multiple tabs playing sound. So if you, say another one's playing sound, you can have one playing sound and another one muted. And once it's clicked to be muted, it'll look like this. So the mute button works when the tab playing sound is selected, and when it's, and also when it's in the background. Last time we talked about storing your data in the cloud. Google provides an easy route to other cloud providers now. To find these, just go to the Google App Store or the Web Store and do a search within the cloud storage provider name, such as Dropbox, as I've done here. And when you key in Dropbox, it comes up. Make sure that you choose the one app that is actually offered by Dropbox, because there's many others with lookalike names. Now, backing up your data should be more natural with more choices. Now, how to use Dropbox? To save files on Dropbox, first, make sure that you install the Dropbox application for either your Chromebook or your Windows computer. The app creates a new folder on your computer called Dropbox. Your Dropbox folder works just like any other folder on your hard drive, except everything in your Dropbox folder automatically syncs to the web and to any other computer with your Dropbox account installed. Drop your files in your Dropbox folder. Yes, it's easy to add files to your Dropbox folder. Just move your files into your Dropbox by dragging and dropping them into your Dropbox folder. That's it. The files in your Dropbox folder will then automatically be synchronized online and will go on to any of your other computers. You don't have to do anything. You can even use the Save As menu option in most applications to save files directly to your Dropbox folder. To share a folder or a file from your Dropbox with your friends, first, you want to make sure that you sign into your Dropbox account or go to the Dropbox website. Go to your list of files and folders and select any of the files or folders that you want to share by hovering the mouse cursor over that particular folder's or file's name. Click the Invite People button to collaborate to give others access to the files in that specific folder. And guess what? That's it. Do you need antivirus software on a Chromebook? Will be the next topic. Guess what? The simple answer is no, you don't. The Chromebook is based on Linux, but is implemented in such a way that it's very hard to install anything that would compromise your device. Your Chromebook, in the default state, allows apps to run within a sandbox, which is a very secure place. But hackers will be hackers, so I do use Chromebook antivirus app from Avast. It's free and does a great job of protecting me and my data. Now, just to let you know what this does, this actually will block me from going into a unsafe website, and if I try to get to that website, it'll come up with a message and say, hey, this site's been known to fish for your data or try to steal your data. And you press a button and it takes you back to safety. There is another button to bypass that and go into that website anyway if you wanted to. So anything, if anything does go wrong within your Chromebook, it's very easy to reset it to the default factory settings and continue right where you left off. So the question is, how do I do this? Well, you go to your Chromebook and then go into your settings. And once you're into your settings, type in power wash. Just like this, power wash. And once you've typed in power wash, the power wash option will come up within your Chromebook settings. and you click on yes, you want to do a power wash, your Chromebook will restart, it will format the drive, it will then come back up in a few seconds. You'll sign into your Chrome account and everything will be just the way you left it. And it takes less than a minute to do it. Alrighty, well, that's our lecture portion of the lesson. We're now going to be working with a number of laptops and desktops today. So let's get started with the work, and here's some background music for our work.
Thank you. Thank you.